In this tutorial, I just want to go over chemical bonds. I think it's very important just to illustrate that the bonding of atoms to each other is done with the valence electrons. And what I mean by that is, if we look at the Rutherford model, if you will, for the hydrogen atom, you've got a proton there for hydrogen, so this is for hydrogen, and that's an electron, and it's whizzing around the nucleus of the atom like this. Now, if you go on to other atoms, so if you go from hydrogen onto helium, I'm very cleverly do that, where it's got two protons and two neutrons, and now it's got two electrons, we find that this element is actually quite stable, and that's because its shell, its electron shell, is actually fully occupied. And what do I mean by that? Well, if we look at the energy level diagrams, or we look at the electronic configuration tutorials, you'll have seen that the electrons occupy certain orbitals. So this is be the 1s, this bottom one here, 1s, this is 2s, and then we've got three very similar ones. That's an s, sorry, but that's an s. And that's 2p. And that can be x, y, or z, or z. And now you and this is basically just the energy going up. Now, the shapes of these orbitals are defined by the quantum numbers, and I won't go into that here, but what is important is these filling of boxes. And now each box represents an electron pair. Electrons can exist as up or down, as different spin systems. You can never have more than one up and one down in an orbital. So here we're allowed to have, in this orbital, these orbitals actually like this, it'll fill it like this. Okay, that's called Hund's rule. And if you look at the electronic configuration tutorial, you'll see what that means in slightly more detail. But basically, you can have what appears to be electrons occupying similar orbitals. But if you look at the shape of these orbitals, these are actually all what's called orthogonal, or right angles to each other, because they're in different planes. So if you look at the 3D plane like this, if you can grasp what this is. So this is like, if you're at school and you do a graph, you've got an XY plane like this. This is Y and that's X. Okay, and these are just the coordinates. So if you look at your tabletop, it's a nice flat structure, and that's what an XY plane represents. You draw a nice square on it like that. But if you want to represent three-dimensional shapes, you need another plane. You need a Z axis like that, and that would be Z sticking out there. It doesn't matter which one you label, that could be X, that could be Y, and that can be Z. It just basically, you need to define which one's which in order to talk to people about it, basically. So that's the difference between these orbitals. One of the orbitals, if I draw it in a different colour, will be one of the p orbitals. It will be on the y axis, that's the y one, and that can have two electrons. Another orbital, if I draw it in a different colour, will be on the x axis. You see how they're at right angles to each other. And the last orbital, hope this colour comes out, will be on the Z axis. And they're the P orbitals. Now I've rapidly skipped all the way over to the shapes of orbitals, but basically what I wanted to explain was these orbitals get full. And when they're full, they're stable, they're happy. So the reactivity elements is determined by basically the outer electrons. Because if you imagine going beyond helium, let's see if we can do it for carbon. Let's see. Let's draw the structure of carbon here. Because carbon will be interesting to look at. So carbon's got 12 nucleons, or it's got 6 protons. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6. And let's draw the neutrons in green. So they're protons, the black ones. And now 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 neutrons. So that's the nucleus of a carbon atom. Now then, if we draw, I'm going to draw it in the Rutherford model, which is wrong. Well, it's less accurate than the current model we have. But I'm going to draw it in the Rutherford model, just basically to explain these energy level differences. So let's draw some circles. Let's see if I can draw this properly. Just get my circle tool. I draw one circle, that's one orbital. Draw another circle. That's 1s and 2s, I've done that. Now the two p's are going to be slightly different now. What I'm going to do, I'm just fill these ones first. So what we need to do is fill these electrons. So we've got, I'll get red for, so this is going to be electrons. The electrons are in red, so we've got 6 electrons to fill here. That's 1, 2, let's fill them as we're going along here. 1, 2, 1 up, 1 down. Then there's 2s, 1, 2, that's 1 up, 1 down. I need to delete them ones, don't I? That'll confuse us. We don't want that. Get rid of them. Okay, now we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, but we need 6. So we're going to have to fill up these orbitals here. So if I draw it in here, you've got 1, oops, let's choose the same colour as before. We've got 1, now following Hund's rule, 2, okay. Now that would probably want to sit in there, to be fair, but we don't know at this stage, because it will then try and pick up electrons or lose electrons. And basically, it's going to try and form bonds, and the best way for its carbon to do that is to grab electrons off another element. So let's have a look at carbon picking electrons off another element, for example hydrogen. So let's go back to hydrogen. So we need to, that's the best way of doing this. I don't know how I'm going to draw this orbital while it's on there. Let's draw it like this. 1, 2 like that. Okay, that is a 2p orbital, and that's got 2 electrons in it, so let's draw 1 electron there. And well, if I've drawn it like that, I better stick to that. So what was the colour of this one? Blue. Let's do the blue one. Let's draw the p orbital like that. Whoosh. Very strange shapes, like dumbbell type of shapes really. Let's just put the electrons in. Okay, so that's what it looks like, and remember, these are a long way away. The way I try to think about the 2p orbital is it does want to form a sphere, okay, and this is the best way of cutting a sphere up into three parts. So if you look at these, they're actually a lot fatter than that. Now, that's just the way I think about it, okay, it's not necessarily true, but it's a good way of wondering why. So if you think about a sphere that's been cut, yeah, and then you have the other one, which was orange, which is not the best colour to choose, but, and then you've got the orange, and then we'll just draw that, whoosh, and then at the back there'll be another one. And you think it's just a sphere has been chopped up into equal parts, it'd form that kind of shape, and that's the way I think about it. It's nothing too clever, it's just another way of giving slightly different attributes to the electrons as they form these shapes. And these have been proven to be pretty accurate when you look at the structure of molecules and things like that. Right, so where am I going with this? We've got a chemical bond, so we need to think about covalent bonds. And basically, what I've been trying to teach you here is that it's the valence electron. So the 2s and the 1s aren't going to take part in bonding, it's only going to be these orbitals here, okay, for carbon. Now, carbon's quite unique. So if we look at, get rid of that, let's move it to one side, I need that letter, and we'll get rid of this. So this you can look up on the electronic configuration tutorial, and this we can get rid of now. So the bonding of carbon can either go through an S-like character, or it can go through a P-like character. If it's pure P, it forms what's called pi bonds. If it goes through S type of character, it forms sigma bonds. Now, as confusing as this representation of orbitals is, it gets a slightly more confusing because we have what's called hybridization. Okay. Now, hybridization means that some of the 2s mixes with some of the 2p to form what's called sp3 or sp2 or sp orbitals. Now, these strange orbitals are just mixtures of the s and the p orbitals together to give peculiar shaped orbitals. So we use carbon and carbon. If these bond together with their valence electrons, what you find is, if I draw it in blue, you have overlap here, and it goes, so this C represents the nucleus, that's the shape of the sp3 orbital. And then if you take, oh, yellow turns out alright on screen, that orbital, the same shape, that's an sp3, that's called a sigma bond, and we write that in our structures as carbon carbon, just a single bond, and that's called a sigma bond, sigma from the Greek letter sigma. Okay, that's called a sigma bond, and that's actually a mixture of a p and an s orbital called sp3. So it's got one s orbital and it's got all three p orbitals. So in this, there would be sp3 means you've got four, because there's one, two, three, four orbitals involved. They'd all be the same, all be called sp3, and they'd all be hybridized. Now that would give you a single bond, so sometimes it's called a single bond. Okay, this is just bonding for carbon. You have different types of bonding for other elements as well. Now, if you have, so you'd have four of these, so that gives rise to structures which are tetrahedral. So carbon would look like this, if you think about it in 3D. That's, so for methane, we draw methane, and methane's tetrahedral. It would look a bit like that, and that bond's going back. So imagine this hydrogen. So imagine this one's actually flat on the page here. This hydrogen's sticking out, and this one's sticking back to give you like a three-dimensional shape, which is tetrahedral. Okay, and that's because there's sp3 hybridized, and sp3 is basically the p orbitals mixing with the 2s orbital. That's 2s there. This one. Okay. And they mix, so they change shape, so they have a different structure to the classical model. So orbitals don't always have the same shape. That's something we need to think about as well.